You wake up in your house and take out an umbrella. It's Saturday, and it's cleaning time. You reach for the magical button, and the dishes, furniture, walls, floors, and even your clothes in the closet get sparkling clean. You have the rest of the day to yourself, and so you lie on the dust-free couch with your favorite book. This sci-fi setting was everyday reality for Frances Gabe for decades. She didn't clean her house at all. She didn't hire anyone to do it. Yet, it remained perfectly clean. Frances was born in 1915 in Idaho. Her father, Frederick, was an architect and building contractor. The family had to move a lot for his job, and Frances attended 18 elementary schools. She said she was born a most unusual person, and everything moved much too slowly for her at school. The girl preferred the company of her dad and his coworkers. She watched them and learned their craft. Frances graduated from Girls Polytechnic High School in Portland at 16. Next year, she got married. By the late 1970s, she was divorced and a single mother of two kids. She always thought of housework as a thankless, unending job. One day, she noticed fig jam slithering down her wall. Frances got so mad, she decided to put an end to all of this for good. She brought out the garden hose, got rid of the jam, and started designing her own self-cleaning house. She spent more than a decade and thousands of dollars of her own savings transitioning her Oregon home into a giant floor-to-ceiling dishwasher. By 1984, it was all finished. Frances received an official U.S. patent for her self-cleaning building construction. It consisted of 68 separate devices that made all the cleaning fully automated. Every room had sprinklers in the ceiling. Frances would put on her raincoat, take out an umbrella, and press a button to activate the sprinklers. They'd spray soap and water in a circular motion. Then it was all rinsed. Warm air then went through the vents to dry it all. In less than an hour, the walls, floors, bathrooms, toilet, and bath were all crisp, clean, and dry. The floors were coated with many layers of marine varnish and ever so slightly tilted toward the walls. There were gutters at the edge of every room. Water from the sprinklers didn't go to waste. It drained out of the house into the doghouse to wash the dog along the way. Furniture that wasn't supposed to get rinsed was covered in clear acrylic cases made of resin. Books had waterproof jackets. Papers were sealed in a plastic box. And pictures on the walls, including the patent, had glass cases to keep them safe. Awnings covered the beds to keep linen dry. Frances also invented her own waterproof fabric for the upholstery. The cupboard would make dishes clean without any assistance needed. Clothes would be placed inside a cabinet on hangers, washed and dried, and then, still on hangers, pulled into the closet with chains. The electrical outlets were all safely covered, of course. There were no carpets or curtains, no dust collectors allowed. Sometimes, the pipes would burst and water would spray in all unwanted directions. But all in all, it was running smoothly for about 20 years. Frances was dreaming about more self-cleaning homes and even self-cleaning office buildings, hospitals, and villages around the world. Her idea was to help single moms and women fed up with cleaning, and also people who can't clean due to health issues. She was traveling the U.S. giving lectures on her invention and showing a model of her design. She was featured in newspapers and on TV, but the idea never took off. By 2002, she couldn't afford to run the house and renew her patents, so they expired. Frances gave tours of the house, so she had some money, but that wasn't enough. This and natural disasters like floods and earthquakes turned the once cleanest house into a cluttered construction. In 2009, the lady moved into a retirement home. The house was sold some years later to a new owner who now has to clean it himself. Many people mocked the idea, and the self-cleaning home revolution never happened. Still, architects and builders these days admit her idea was functional and worth bringing to life. In 1998, when computers were taking off and taking up all of your attention, someone came up with and patented a brilliant idea of a motivational candy dispenser. It would be equipped with an optical sensor attached to your screen. The sensor keeps an eye on all of your activities and rewards you with candy for sending a work email or finishing a long important paper. The more work tasks you perform, the more candy you get. A cyborg-like wrist pouch to carry pencils, phone, lip balm, and other little necessities on your wrist was patented in 2001. If you don't enjoy raking leaves in the fall, you'd probably love the unique solution described by its inventor as compatible with the natural body movement of a person. Leaf-gathering pants have zip-on flexible tubes attached to pant legs and a net fastened in between to gather leaves as you walk. You can easily remove the large piles you leave behind later. The greenhouse helmet was designed to bring nature to big city guys. You put on a self-enclosed anti-fog covered dome on your head with tiny plants on built-in shelves. When you exhale, the plants take care of all the bad elements and recharge you with the purest oxygen. The helmet would be equipped with an intercom system to let you communicate with people outside your dome. In case you have a pet but don't have 24 hours in the day to give it all the non-stop physical attention it wants, the automatic pet petter is something you'd appreciate. It works for both cats and dogs with its mechanical hand and plays relaxing tunes to them. The gadget is activated when Spotter Jingles gets on a motion sensor platform. Pet ears can get in the wrong places, like a soup plate, and spread the food all over the place. Back in 1980, someone decided to take care of it and patented the lightweight, adjustable, and easy-to-use animal ear protectors. They were designed especially for pets, mostly dogs, with long ears to prevent any contact with food. They also suggested decorating the tubes on special occasions. An anti-eating face mask was invented around the same time for those who have to spend their days around food for professional reasons. Chefs, cooks, and other restaurant staff dealing with food can put it on and lock it with a little padlock. Breathing and talking are still possible, but it makes eating highly problematic. The most important thing is not to lose that key, or you'd have to go on an eternal diet. Sled pants were equipped with a seat to slide down hills, and leg and waist straps to keep them securely attached to the owner. They were configured to take the shape of the human body. To stop the sled once you reach your destination, you'd have to fold the lower part up and walk away, pretending you didn't just ride your own pants. The 1923 head exerciser was invented to give you better circulation. Two people would hold a metal plate between their teeth. The plates were held together by a spring. As the pair pulled each in their direction, they'd take part in a sort of tug-of-war for the head. Someone came up with a brilliant idea of a watch that would let you know how long you have left to live in years, months, and minutes. The life expectancy guess would be based on some statistical methods and personal health factors of the owner. The watch had a microprocessor for storing data and buttons and switches to reset that data. Pet display clothing would be the perfect choice for those who can't leave their master at home alone. It's a vest or a belt with many tubular passageways going all around the body of the owner. The whole construction is see-through. There are little chambers for feeding and to take the pet out. An automatic tip requester consisted of an artificial hand and a box for cash to wear on your wrist. When the money someone would drop down the connecting tube didn't seem enough, a no sale sign would pop up. Sea shoes, invented in the 1960s, made walking on water possible. They used duck foot propellers and required some good sense of balance from the owner to stay afloat.